Welcome back to Exotic Astrology, ladies and gentlemen. And Mercury has entered his sign of exaltation, or I would say he's going to enter after 2 days, and he will stay there for the next 25, 28 days from now. And this is a very important transit because once in a year, Mercury goes into the sign of exaltation in Virgo. All right, so depending on your dashas, you will see how this transit will affect you. Okay, so if you are new to the channel and if you have not yet subscribed, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding this transit or any other area of your life, then please go down to the description section of my videos down below, where you will find the link to my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. So what is Mercury? Mercury represents our ability to understand the things of this world. That is why it is the significator of communication. Many times people think communication is external. So I am communicating with you, he is communicating with him, she is communicating with her. Well, that's true, but there is another person who we are communicating 24 hours with. Who is that person? Yes, it is we ourselves. Okay, and as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, that there is another person who is always situated in your heart, and that is Krishna himself. Yes, he says this. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishtati. So now, at least we communicate with ourselves. When we are elevated spiritually, we can also communicate with God. Or rather, we can understand that he is already communicating with us. Okay. Not that once we become elevated, then we start communicating with him. He's always communicating, but we can't listen to him because our mind is blocked by so many materialistic desires. So what happens when Mercury enters Virgo? Mercury is probably the only planet which gets exalted in his own house. So no other planet gets exalted in his own house. Jupiter goes to Cancer. Venus goes to Pisces, Saturn goes to Libra, Sun goes to Aries, Moon goes to Taurus, Mars goes to Capricorn. And Mercury is the only planet which loves his house, which loves his sign so much. Well, that is the place where he can manifest his ideals in the most concrete way. So now Virgo is a dual sign. And it is also an earthy sign. Okay, that is why it represents the sixth house of finances. So, what is that which is there in Virgo, which is not there in Taurus? What is that? That speciality about Virgo is it is a dual sign. Now you may be thinking, oh, but what's so special about duality? Duality means you can understand both the pros and cons. And now you may be thinking, oh, well, then Gemini is also a dual sign. In Gemini, what happens? You understand the duality, which means you understand this is good, this is not good, this is right for me, this is not right. What will give me better things in life? What will not? That's what Gemini represents. But in Gemini, you don't start doing. And unless you do, actions don't manifest. So therefore, when Mercury enters Virgo, then he starts doing things. Okay. So this also means putting your ideals, your plans into execution. Because if you're simply just planning things and not, I mean, if you just have goals and you don't have any plan, any concrete plan, then things will not work out for anybody. All right, so now is the time that whichever houses Mercury rules in your chart, depending on your ascendant, okay, I'm repeating, depending on your ascendant, whichever houses Mercury rules in your chart, it is a great time to implement those aspects in your life. And Mercury has been in a difficult situation from some time, I would say, because first he was in Cancer after being in Gemini and then again in Leo. Well, Leo is still decent. But now Mercury is in Virgo. So Mercury is considered to be exalted here. So what does it mean to be exalted? Exalted doesn't mean good and debilitation doesn't mean bad. Exalted means the planet is highly aware, which means whichever houses Mercury rules in your chart, you will see in as the week starts, that your awareness, the knowledge of how to implement the aspects of that planet, of that house, through that planet, I mean, that will come for some time, okay? And depending on your dasha, it will be decided what's how, in which area of your life that will manifest. Which means, so suppose, for example, you are running Venus Mahadasha and any Antardasha, for example, okay? It could be any Antardasha. So when in Venus you are running any Antardasha, then it could mean that this Mercury will revolve around your married life or your spouse or love, romance, these kind of things. But suppose Venus is ruling your 10th house, if you are a Capricorn Lagna, then what will happen? Well, then it can also mean things related to your career because the lordship is also important. Okay. So therefore, when Mercury enters Virgo, it is as if planets are entering the sixth house because Virgo is the original sixth house. Okay. And when planets enter Virgo, then the critical thinking starts, which means we start analyzing things in a way which will give us results in the long run, not just sitting and analyzing things. Now, of course, that will also depend on how strong your Lagna Lord is, or how strong your sixth lord in your chart, how strong is he? How well is your sixth lord placed? Okay. So many times people think that if the sixth lord is exalted, then the enemies are very powerful. No, it doesn't mean that. It means that your awareness to deal with your enemies is very strong because it is your sixth lord. It is not your enemy's sixth lord. Your sixth lord will show your awareness. Okay. And of course, where your Mercury is in your original birth chart, because your sixth lord can be anybody. It's not necessary that it is Mercury. Of course, if you're Aries Lagna, then definitely it's Mercury, but it's not mandatory. Okay. Because Mercury only rules two signs, so two ascendants will have Mercury as the sixth lord and the others will not. Okay. So the point is, utilize this year, this month of the year, to plan for the remaining part of the year. Well, that's a very strong statement. Using this month, which is this month of September, to plan for the rest of the month, the entire year, my God. What about when Sun is in Aries? No, that's not the time. That is a time when Sun enters Aries, which is around that April time, that we have a vision for the year. Okay, vision is different and plan is different. Vision means you decide what you want to do in life. All right? Planning means you try to see how you can implement that vision. Okay. So now is the best time actually. Every year when Mercury enters Virgo, it is the best time to plan for the remaining months of the year. And when I say year, I mean till next September, not December. Okay. Because December is already around the corner. You see, just barely 3 4 months are remaining. And now Sun is also in Leo, and Venus will also enter Virgo. I'll make that a Venus video later during this month. And Mercury will be giving Nich Bhanga to Venus because Venus will get debilitated in Virgo and Mercury will result in the cancellation of the debility. But anyways, nonetheless, this is also a time where we can revisit our existing plans regarding any area of your life. So for example, if you are having some plans in your career and you have been working, now is the time you actually see why you are not seeing results. Okay. If you want a promotion and you are not getting, then you sit and analyze why. What is that that I'm not doing? Where am I going wrong? You can make new plans, that's fine. But one of the biggest problems which people face today is that people have become very good in making, in starting with plans. Okay, very visionary, brainstorming, all this fancy stuff. But the problem is they are lacking the consistency to carry on with those plans. So therefore, not only should we start new plans, we should also make sure that we execute our old plans which have not reached completion. And Virgo deals with a lot of patience because there are three nakshatra. The first nakshatra is Uttara Falguni, which comes in. Virgo starts from the second pada of Uttar Falguni, second, third, fourth. Okay. Uttar Falguni is actually the time when you should be doing all this, the planning stuff basically. Okay. Because Uttar Falguni deals with contracts, deals, negotiations, deals with deals. All right. Making things structured. And then comes Hasta Nakshatra, which deals with hands, which means going and doing stuff. You made plans, you made all the records, all the accounts. Any planet which transits Hasta, regarding that planet's lordship, you may start doing things related to with your hand. Okay. And many times I have seen, if the fourth lord transits Hasta, then people go into gardening and all this. Fourth house is the house of the mother. So you feel like doing some motherly activity, which maybe is gardening, when you go and water plants, trees, roots. These are the things. Or I have seen when eighth lord transits Hasta, then I have seen, you know, people start going and digging the ground, because eighth house is the graveyard. And the ground is also like the graveyard sometimes. So you dig out. So that's what Hasta can make us do. And once Hasta is done, then we enter Chitra Nakshatra, where the picture starts to become clear. Because Chitra is known as the shining jewel. Which means what you start in Uttar Falguni, you carry on in Hasta. And that is why Hasta has to deal with perfection also. Hasta people can be obsessed with perfection, and that could be good, and at times that could become a very big challenge, especially in relationships. Alright, so Chitra is the one where you finally end your journey. Now, Chitra's some part falls in Virgo and the remaining falls in Libra. So the Chitra part which is in Virgo is different from the Chitra part which is in Libra. Okay. So what is Chitra, the padas which fall in Virgo? What is that? It is like refining. Refining means you are polishing something, like a jewel. Jewel. Why is it known as the shining jewel? Because if you want that a jewel should shine, you have to polish it. Without polishing, the jewel will not shine. So the part of Chitra which falls under Virgo, you may not see the shine, but you are giving the finishing, see? And that is why they say that if you want to know how pure the gold is, then just put it in fire. So if the gold is very pure, the more you put it in fire, the more it will glow and it will shine, it will be bright, it will be effulgent, it will be radiating light all over. But that same gold, if it is not very good in quality, then it will maybe, it will just disappear. Okay. So now when the Chitra part of Virgo has some transits, then that final finishing, it's like saying somebody has a stick, and with the stick he's doing tuck, 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 like this. Finishing part is going on. preparing for perfection. That's what Chitra is. I mean, the Virgo part. And then when it goes to Libra, you are like, hey, this is my jewel. Can you see it? Or you don't see it? No problem. You will anyway see it. Or nobody needs to tell you. So any planet that transits the Chitra part of Libra, okay, I mean within Libra, the Padas, then that you will feel as if something great has been accomplished, which people are recognizing. In Virgo, nobody will recognize you, but in Libra, everybody recognizes. Okay, so that is how the nakshatras are flowing, and that is how you will know what exactly the planets will do, not just that it is entering Virgo, this will happen. Okay, you must go deep down into the nakshatras, otherwise you will not understand how this is happening. And to understand nakshatras more, I have been doing sessions with Aman Bedi ji from AB Astrology, Aman Bedi Astrology, and just yesterday we had a conversation, not a very long one of course, where he was sharing with me some unique nakshatra remedies from trees. My God, I was astonished when I heard the presentation. I was like, maybe such work has never been done by, I won't say astrologer, maybe any human being in this earth, or maybe in the higher planetary realms also. And there were so many slides, and he said he will be discussing about seven nakshatras specifically. Okay. And he has also made connections with many stories from the Vedas, the Upanishads, the Puranas. And I was astonished that he's going on quoting shlokas. This is from here, this is from there. Okay. So whenever we are having time, maybe this week or the next weekend, we will try to record it depending on his availability. And once that is ready, I will upload it. All right. So brilliant analysis by him, and I was astonished to see just by trees and so many other things. Okay. So for this transit, I would say you can read about Uttar Falguni Nakshatra. You can read about the life of Arjun, because Arjun is very prominent because he had Uttar Falguni as his Janma Nakshatra. Okay. And you can also read about Hasta. Hasta Nakshatra is very important. And you can also read about Chitra. You can read about Vishwakarma and the creation of Dwaraka city. Okay. So these are very important things which you must read. Okay. So for Hasta, you can also read the story of Vamandev. It is to some extent linked. Shravan Nakshatra. Okay. That I will explain you some other day, how, why it is linked. Okay. All right. So thank you very much for your patience. And if you want a consultation from me regarding this transit, then you can go down to the description section where you will find the link to my website. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who wants to know what happens when Mercury enters Virgo. All right. Thank you very much and wish you all the best. Oh yeah, just before you go, many people have been requesting me videos for the Ashtak Varga series again, for career and for childbirth, and some are also asking for love romance. So I will be uploading those videos, okay, very soon. All right. So you'll get it. All right. Thank you.